286, 386, 486? In this episode of Byte Size, we're looking why there was a Pentium instead of a 586. The IBM Personal Computer, model number 5150. It's a machine I often start with, and for good reason, because it's the forefather of every IBM PC compatible we have today. Created in 1981, using mostly off-the-shelf parts, the central processor chosen to be the core of this technology was Intel's 8088, clocking in at an impressive 4.77 MHz. Itself a descendant of the Intel 8008, which itself was the successor to the Intel 4004, released in 1971. Intel's first commercially available microprocessor. Even before this, Intel had used numbering for its components, which correlated to an in-house code. The first digit indicated the process technology used, the second its generic function, and the final two digits the sequential number identifying the component's development. Intel's new microprocessors would break from this norm a little, with designer Federico Fagan leapfrogging a few numbers to avoid disrupting the numbering applied to groups of compatible components. After all, this was a microprocessor and could handle many tasks by itself. To form its own compatible family of components, the 4001 control memory, 4002 data storage, and 4003 bus expansion chips were also created. This numbering would continue with Intel's subsequent microprocessors, the 8086, 8186, 8286, 8386, 8486, with each new design jumping 100 to indicate the ushering in of a new phase. But after that, things changed. Why? Both Intel and Advanced Micro Devices were set up by ex-employees of Fairchild Semiconductor, a company which started in 1957 and ruled the Silicon Valley roost throughout the 1960s. So when Intel started creating microprocessors in large numbers, it created an industry-standard second source program whereby AMD would assist in the production of their processors. A deal was instigated where both companies could have access to technology and act as second sources for each other. So, in exchange for access to their processors, Intel wanted something equivalent in return from AMD. But by the time the Intel 386 was ready, Intel decided AMD seemed to have little on the table, and actually rejected their quad-pixel display manager chip, somewhat breaching their good faith. From 1985, Intel took the decision to manufacture all 386 chips completely under their own initiative, bypassing the second source deal. This exclusivity meant that protecting their processors from infringement was suddenly more pertinent. This was especially true when AMD successfully managed to create their own 386 clone through reverse engineering of Intel's chip a few years later. Intel got wind of this through a tale stranger than fate. AMD's marketing manager, Mike Webb, was checked into a hotel in Sunnyvale, California, awaiting a package. Curiously, an Intel engineer, also by the name of Mike Webb, was staying at the same hotel. And lo and behold, the package was accidentally delivered to him rather than the AMD Mike. The literature in this package gave away the 386 game, and Intel quickly sought to sue AMD for infringement. Now to me, this sounds like an intentional plant by Intel, and AMD would later query the integrity of this course of events. In the meantime, it meant AMD had to delay their processor release until, in March 1991, the judge sided with AMD, having created their chip using their own process and declaring the 386 trademark itself as too generic. AMD also argued that due to the earlier contract between the two companies, they had the right to use Intel's microcode for subsequent chip generations. This created further lawsuits until the end of 1994, and also led to Intel creating the Intel Inside marketing campaign to enforce brand identity. AMD would release their AM386 competitor in 1991, some 6 years after Intel released their version, and began to capture their own portion of the x86 market. Intel would try and register both 486 and 586, but abandoned its applications, even attempting I-586, but only seeking approval on the grounds that no exclusive claim to use the 586 standalone was made. Enter Lexicon, a marketing company Intel gave the task of creating a name, which sounded integral to the computer. CEO David Plasek initially thought up Pentagon, referencing the Greek number 5, indicating that this was the 5th generation of processor. Agon was then changed to Eum, sounding more scientific like an element, and in March 1993 the Pentium brand was born, a brand name which by the late 90s would become more recognisable than Intel itself, although not everyone appreciated it. Other manufacturers would conveniently tow the 586 and 686 line in the wake of this, before following suit with their own brands. It was clear that there was power in the word, given that words are just easier to remember. It's also clear that Intel do still like numbers, having resorted in part at least to using them in their more contemporary range of processors, but alongside specific usage guidelines, of course, just to make sure that there's no mishaps and confusion. And that's it for this Byte Size. There's some links below if you fancy a bit more information on this. Otherwise, have a great evening!